Welcome back, sports fans, to the first episode of the Sports Rundown. I'm Cannon Bird alongside Chandler Ducote. Our goal is to keep you guys updated on a weekly basis about things happening in the world of sports. We'll be covering topics such as the NFL, NBA, MLB, and NCAA, along with recapping the week's top scores, stories, and highlights. We'll also bring up and discuss some controversial topics among sports fans. So let's get right into the action, starting with the NBA, Chandler.
All right, so recently, Vince Carter, the immortal basketball player, played in the league for 22 years and is 42 years old, re-signed with the Hawks for a one-year deal. Now, just to give you a perspective, he was playing pro ball before four of his teammates were born. So, Trae Young wasn't even born. Like, I saw the graphic on SportsCenter, and most of his teammates were, like, less than a year old when he started playing pro ball.
I mean, when you think about it, he was playing ball. I think he got drafted in the 96, 97 class. I mean, he was just an absolute standout. Winning the dunk contest like crazy in the early 2000s. I mean, he was one of the biggest players in the league for a long time. And he did say this was supposed to be his last season, but I think he said that last year too.
Yeah. We'll see how it goes after this season with Vince Carter.
All right, so next up, we got Coach Greg Popovich and Team USA. Team USA is going to be struggling a little bit this year, I feel. We've had a lot of big names decline an invitation to play on the Team USA team. We have big names like Damian Lillard, CJ McCollum, Bradley Beal, James Harden, Anthony Davis, Kevin Love, Andre Drummond. They all declined for whatever their specific reasons were. So Coach Pop is stuck with people like his best options are probably Kemba Walker, Donovan Mitchell, De'Aaron Fox, one of the younger guys. They got guys like Kyle Kuzma, but then they also have guys like Mason Plumlee, which you rarely ever see. I don't think that he's made an All-Star game yet. People like P.J. Tucker, Brooke Lopez, you know, some of the more veteran guys, but not any of the standout guys that we see today in the NBA.
And, you know, honestly, if you look around the world, the NBA, and I guess you could say American basketball, other than, you know, the few standout guys from different countries and like Giannis Antetokounmpo from Greece, you know, but if you look at it, basketball has been at the top for a very long time. And now you say these aren't our best players. I think having these young guys and giving them that experience of playing on Team USA, I think it's a great opportunity for them. But it shows where we stand in the rankings of, you know, basketball, and since we're not playing with our best guys.
Right, we're just got to see how they fare in this 2020 FIBA World Cup. Next thing, Pels are starting to build big around their number one overall draft pick, Zion Williamson. They're bringing in veterans such as J.J. Redick, Derek Favors, and they also brought in Lonzo Ball, Josh Hart, and Brandon Ingram in that monumental AD trade to the L.A. Lakers. Also re-signing was Drew Holiday, and Pelicans did also acquire the big man from the EuroLeague, Darius Bertrands, who did lead the EuroLeague in scoring last year. So Pelicans looking to have a bigger, better offense.
And, you know, you talk about having AD, and, you know, he great player. But I think towards the end, they wanted to build around AD, but towards the end, they didn't have the cap space. They didn't have all the different things to build around AD, and I think that's what struggled the Pelicans. So I think now that they have more cap space with that monumental trade with AD, you got three players and a bunch of draft picks out of it. Honestly, I think the Zion move was definitely I love AD and everything, but I think the Zion move was definitely a lot better move than AD going forward.
And you see the AD move, when the Pelicans did land the number one overall pick in the draft lottery, VP of operations, David Griffin, was really hoping that would entice AD to, you know, try to stay with New Orleans, but he was just ready to get out. He's ring chasing, if we're going to be honest. I mean, but what superstar player really doesn't want to ring? I mean, if you're playing at that level of play for, 6 years, and we barely even have any playoff appearances to show for it, I don't blame AD for being upset with his team. And like you said, the draft picks. We got three draft picks in the first round. Like you said, number one overall, we got Zion. Number eight overall, we got from Atlanta. We did draft the big man Jackson Hayes, who had an absolutely monstrous dunk in the NBA Summer League, if you remember that. and also Nikhil Alexander Walker, the 17th overall pick out of Virginia Tech, who did, I'm pretty sure he was about probably second or third in the summer league in scoring. He did. He's also a big three-point threat, which is what the Pelicans have struggled with the past couple years. J.J. Redick is a guy they brought in. Redick did, at some point, lead the league in three-point percentage, so we'll see if that can help the Pelicans shoot the three ball a little better this season.
Yeah, and, you know, you talk about the Pelicans, and they are a young team, but it's not like they don't have talent. They are stacked with talent. They're a young team, and I think it's only up from here with the Pelicans, honestly.
I couldn't say it any better myself. Last story for the NBA, Los Angeles building a big market for basketball. Both the Clippers and the Lakers making big moves this offseason. Like we said, the Lakers got Anthony Davis in that trade to New Orleans. They already had LeBron from this past season, and they did add DeMarcus Cousins. They signed him this past season. And the Clippers also made two big moves, signing both Paul George and Kawhi Leonard, the reigning NBA Finals MVP, which is it's the first time in NBA history that a Finals MVP has not re-signed with his team that just won the NBA Finals. So it's very monumental for the Clippers to try to rebuild that LA team.
Over to the NFL, breaking news. AB, Antonio Brown, wide receiver for the Oakland Raiders, has injured his foot. I believe it was from the cryogenic tank. Basically what it is it's a rehab thing, and it's where they put liquid nitrogen in it, and it basically helps with soreness and things like that. But he wasn't wearing the proper footwear, and now his foot is the bottom of his foot is his skin's peeling off. So definitely worrisome for the Oakland Raiders since the new acquisition. Worried about his future with the team, especially since I think it was like third-degree burns. And it's extreme frostbite, so they're just kind of taking it week by week, seeing how it's going to go. Don't know if it's too serious yet. Don't know if it's just going to be a week thing. Not too sure. But I'll throw in a picture. It's definitely looking a little rough for Antonio Brown. They call him Mr. Toe Tap. But can't be Mr. Toe Tap if you don't have any toes.
That's right.
But in other news, the Pro Bowl was moved to Orlando for the fourth straight year. Previously, it was in Hawaii. And as me and Kanan were talking about it earlier, it was more basically a paid vacation.
You had players that, of course they were amazing players, but once they got to Hawaii, they got to stay down there a week for free. And once they got to the field on game day, they basically just took it not even really half speed. You see like practices, teams will call it taking it half speed. They won't really hit each other or whatever. But, there was barely any tackles made. They had that one clip from about 5 or 6 years ago where there was almost no effort on the either line. They were barely even touching each other during a run play. But I feel like Orlando is a good spot to have it, a nice area.
It's a nice area. It's not as far, it's not as far. It's not like most people you can drive to Orlando or you can fly into Orlando, but it's not as expensive as to fly to Hawaii for a week to watch a football game. You can just, go to Orlando, and that's for us because we live in Louisiana, but it's still in the mainland of the United States.
Right.
So I think that's good for the NFL. You saw a few years ago where it was the NFL Hall of Famers, NFL legends that picked the teams, and it was more of a show thing. And honestly, I think now going back to its original format where it's the AFC versus the NFC, I think that's more of I think it gives you bragging rights for whoever wins.
Right.
And so,
because you have players from the same team being on opposite teams when you have when you had the draft style Pro Bowl, which it's kind of created some tension between teammates sometimes, But it was all for the love of the game, fun of the sport. But I believe that, like you said, switching it back to its original AFC versus NFC play style will benefit the NFL a little bit more.
Yep. So big news out of the Saints training camp. Mike Thomas now is the highest paid wide receiver in the NFL. 5 years, I believe, $61 million.
$61 million.
Yeah, so definitely well deserved. Definitely great player, has great talent. Kind of getting that veteran status now. Been in the league for a few years. Still a relatively young player, but with Drew Brees behind center, Mike Thomas out wide, I think Saints are definitely have one of the best, if not the best, wide receiver QB duos. And you know, he was kind of holding out at the beginning of training camp.
Right, like you said, but you got to pay the man. I mean, yeah. The guy's been putting up monster numbers for I think 3 years now. I think this will be his third or fourth year in the league. He's been putting up monster numbers, so he's going to want a big paycheck. And, you know, Drew Brees, a couple years left in him maybe. You know, he's getting ready to hang up the cleats. They're going to have to be paying Mike Thomas if they want to keep him because the thing is they're going to have some cap space once Drew Brees comes. But the thing about Drew Brees is he's willing to take a pay cut to help pay a player, which is what he said he would do. He said he'd lower his salary in order to help keep other players on there because he's just a big team player like that. He's not in it for the money. He just wants to play the sport because he loves it so much.
And, you know, we kind of saw Mike Thomas holding out, beginning of training camp. He finally got paid. But one player that is still holding out as of today, Ezekiel Elliott, you know, another running back. Last year we saw Le'Veon Bell hold out the entirety of the season. He's now with the Jets, obviously. But Ezekiel Elliott, for the running back for the Cowboys, is holding out until he gets paid. Kind of a big name out there. Holding out,
you know,
especially for the Cowboys.
I mean, in his first year, I believe he led the league in rushing yards.
Yeah.
I mean, they definitely relied on him, and he and Dak Prescott, great running back quarterback tandem. Both of them. I mean, you know, Dak Prescott, a mobile quarterback. I mean, both of them are a threat to run the ball. And see, when you're able to establish that ground game like the Cowboys have with that amazing offensive line they have, it opens up the middle of the field more for passes from Dak, which allows that Cowboys offense to be as threatening as it is.
And, you know, they lost Des Bryant. Don't have that. I mean, if you lose Ezekiel Elliott to this holdout, I think the Cowboys season will be very short-lived.
And, you know, Des, like you were saying, he did go to the New Orleans Saints, signed with them. But he's been plagued by injury, you know.
Yeah.
He never really got to play with New Orleans after he signed with his new team.
And I think it was maybe a week after he got signed. He was training, and I believe he hurt his knee. So
yeah, and you saw some players in training camp, they like to throw up the X for Dez. I saw like Mike Thomas do that a couple times for a touchdown celebration. But they're in for Dez to get back this season. So we'll see how that works out. In other news with Oakland, they are planning their move to Las Vegas in 2020, as we all know. But John Gruden, coach, has recently released the name for their new stadium. They're planning on naming it Allegiant Stadium. Once they move to Las Vegas, the stadium is already underway being built. It's almost complete. But, you know, once St. Louis moved back to L.A., the Rams, it's kind of drawn attention away from other NFL franchises. You know, there's like four teams in California.
Yeah.
So Oakland is looking for a new fan base. They're trying to gain more popularity. And Las Vegas is becoming a big spot. You know, the NHL just had that expansion team, the Golden Knights, who in their first season, surprisingly, made it to the Stanley Cup Finals. Ended up losing in, I believe, seven games to the Washington Capitals. But, Las Vegas is becoming a big hub for sports, possibly, in the near future.
Sorry, I thought the St. Louis Blues won.
I thought it was Washington. No, you were right. Okay.
All right. Well, I'm going to leave that in there for a pain in the seat.
I'm not much of a hockey fan, but.
But anyway, so, you know, with the Raiders moving to Las Vegas, you know, it's a big market, you could say, you know. But the problem is when you think of Las Vegas, you think of gambling and things like that. And so it's just kind of worrisome for some of the players. You know, L.A. is a big market, too. But you're just worried about what they're doing in the offseason and things like that, especially in Las Vegas and such the environment in Las Vegas.
Right.
So I think that was kind of worrisome for some of the owners. But ended up, they're going to move in the 2020 to Allegiant Stadium. So, Kane, I think you have some preseason power rankings for us.
Yeah, preseason power rankings. Preseason is starting this week. I know my team, the Saints, will be playing Friday night in the week one of the preseason. But power rankings, top five right now, according to the NFL, the Patriots leading off at number one. Of course, coming in after Tom Brady's sixth Super Bowl. You know, they're still looking to stay hot. Rams coming in at number two. Number three coming in is the New Orleans Saints, followed by the Chiefs at number four. And number five is the Chargers, led by Phillip Rivers and Joey Bosa on that D-line. So we're expecting to see some big things out of the NFL this season. There's been a lot of moves in the offseason. But the majority of these teams are have been on top for the past couple years, looking to try to get another Super Bowl ring.
And let's hope the Saints don't get played by bad refs, miracle plays, and
injury.
Yeah. And honestly, hopefully we can get some things going for our Saints. You know, they've just been plagued by bad luck. It seems
the past two seasons we've been plagued. 2 years ago was the Minnesota Miracle with Stephon Diggs, and last year, the no call on the pass interference that is still being looked at. There's been some people trying to arrange some suits.
Yeah. And so, you know, you think about it, you know, they're changing the rule book.
Right.
Just around that play. That's how bad of a call it was, honestly.
Right.
So, looking forward to see some change in the NFL. So, that'll be it for the NFL.
MLB, you know, Kanan, you want to go over some trades that have been going on, especially with the Astros?
Yeah, Astros. I mean, telling you, they added another big pitching arm to that already scary rotation. They get Zach Greinke at the trade deadline, and that now turns the rotation to Justin Verlander, Zach Greinke, Wade Miley, and Garrett Cole. They also still have Lance McCullers. He is on the IL right now. But that pitching staff for the Astros is fourth in the MLB in ERA, first in opposing batting average, and second in the MLB in WHIP, which is walks plus hits per inning pitch.
And you know, that's the thing. You can have a great rotation. Pitching is one of a very strong point in baseball. But you can go back to previous years and say, oh well, pitching is, you know, you can have a great pitching rotation. But because you can look at the 2018 Astros, Justin Verlander, Garrett Cole, Charlie Morton, Dallas Keuchel, Lance McCullers Jr., and they ended up losing to the Red Sox. And, you know, you can go to the 2014 Tigers, Detroit Tigers. You had Verlander, Max Scherzer, Rick Porcello, Sanchez, Drew Smiley. And then you can keep going on through history. You got 2011 Phillies, 2003 Cubs, 1995 Braves, 1986 Astros, 1971 Orioles, 1966 Dodgers, 1954 Indians. And you can keep going down throughout history in the MLB and say, yes, they have a great regular season. They, you know, monumental things in the regular season. It's whether they can go the distance in the postseason, because you know, you can do great things in the regular season. You know, you can go undefeated in the regular season as long as you don't come out in the end with the World Series. It's all for nothing, honestly. If you think of it like that, what I'm trying to say is that the rotation is not all that matters.
Right.
You have to, you know, go into the bullpen and things like that.
Right. And you see their bullpen's okay.
Yeah.
It's not as strong as it could be, but the thing is, their offense is just so stacked.
Yeah.
So that offense helps back up that bullpen, because, you know, let's say Verlander comes in and gives up five runs, you know, that offense is going to come right back in there and just continue to score and score in big chunks. So as long as that offense can keep scoring, if that bullpen isn't as great as it can be, I think it still helps push them towards the fact that they are probably World Series bound this year.
Yeah, and honestly, you saw it last year. They had a great regular season, great rotation, great offense. It's just whether or not the bullpen can deliver in times of need.
And we did see them. They lost last year in the ALCS to the Boston Red Sox.
Five games, yeah.
Yeah, speaking of Boston, the reigning World Series champs had an eight-game losing streak coming into this past week. They were looking pretty solid to try to make a run for that wild card spot. Yankees still are at the top of the AL East. They're trying to make one last push after the All-Star break, but they did have that losing streak. They did beat Kansas City in game one of their series, but ended up dropping game two, which makes them 1-9 in their last 10 games. So that's a kind of a bad bounce back for the World Series champs.
Yeah, on the struggle bus, the Red Sox are. So
no doubt.
Also, another topic about the Red Sox, this just came in today. Dustin Pedroia, one of the best second basemen ever played for the team, has been trying to make a comeback in baseball, you know, for a couple years now.
He's had that sliding injury.
Yeah, had that sliding injury. He messed up his knee. He's been trying to come back for a couple of two, 3 years now, but he thought he was going to be ready to come back, but had another knee surgery today. So his return to the league will be postponed for the foreseeable future. So,
yeah, Red Sox just can't catch a break right about now. Tim Beckham, PED, performing enhancing drugs, suspended 80 games.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
He's a Mariners utility player. He got tested positive for the drug Stanozol, which is, like you said, a performance enhancing drug. And the thing is, there's not even 80 games in the season left for the Mariners, so his suspension will carry on into the 2020 season. I think it'll be for the first 32 games of the 2020 season is how it's going to play out for him. I think there's 48 left in the season for the Mariners, so we'll see how that happens. And currently this season, he was hitting .237 with 15 home runs, so he was a pretty decent help in the offensive category for the Mariners.
So you want to go into we can go more into the trade because we were just talking about the pitching rotation. Big trade. Yasiel Puig goes to the Reds.
Indians.
Was on the Reds.
Yes.
Goes to the Indians. Trevor Bauer. Last appearance for him. He chunked a ball over the center field wall. I think it went 354 feet.
Hey, it was an impressive throw. That's all I'm going to say. I mean, he did have a bad outing. Their manager did come out to pull him from the game. And as soon as the manager stepped out of the dugout, he saw that happening. Just immediately took the ball, faced towards center field, and threw a laser shot over the center field wall. I think it hit the scoreboard. It didn't hit anybody, thank God. But, you know, it could have hit somebody. It could have hurt somebody. But I think MLB was wanting to suspend him for that.
Yeah, well, luckily that didn't happen. But so you want to go on more about some MLB-type things?
More about Puig. He was involved in that Reds-Pirates brawl that happened a couple days ago, if you guys hadn't heard about that. Eight people between the Reds and the Pirates were suspended. Puig, like we said, got suspended for 3 games. Pirates manager Clint Hurdle was suspended for 2. And Reds manager David Bell was suspended for 6 games among 5 other players who got different suspensions ranging from 2 games to 10 games depending on the severity of how involved they were in the fight. But the fight had been brewing, you know.
It was building up throughout the game.
I mean, yeah.
Batters were getting hit, you know. Pitchers were just, it was running up.
Yeah. So in the ninth inning, Reds closing pitcher Amir Garrett, I believe, gave up a 3-run home run. And after that, Reds manager David Bell came out to pull him from the game. And there's been some conspiracy thinking that David Bell kind of nudged Amir Garrett over there to go fight because he kind of tapped him on the butt and he immediately walked towards the Pirates dugout.
If you think about it, you can say conspiracy or not, but, you know, most coaches, you know, they'll come pull their guy and they'll be like, hey, good game, you know.
Right.
You give him a little slap on the butt. Well, he said, all right, well, I'm not on the mound anymore, so I'm going to go to the Pirates bullpen, to the dugout, and I'm going to throw these hands, is what he's saying.
I think 3 Pirates standing outside the dugout. He went straight at them and just started throwing haymakers. Luckily, I don't think anybody called one of those haymakers. But, like you said, 8 players ended up getting suspended because of that fight. Ended up rushing to the Pirates bench. But Puig will serve his 3-game suspension with his new team, the Cleveland Indians, because he was traded during that game.
Yeah.
I think it was right before he fought, he got traded.
I saw a thing on Twitter where this guy's videoing in the outfield, and I think it was the left fielder, and he's like, hey, just letting you know, Puig got traded. And he's like, what? And he shows him the screenshot on his phone, and nobody knew. They were in the middle of a game while he got traded, and I guess Puig had some news when they got back after the end of the inning.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure Puig was like, hey, bro, you're not on the team anymore. And he was like, really? Okay.
Haymaker. So,
yeah.
We're going to talk about some power rankings real quick.
Playoff pictures. Last thing for the MLB playoff pictures in the AL. New York, Houston, Minnesota all leading their respective divisions. Current teams in the wild card, Cleveland Indians, Tampa Bay Rays. It's not really that tight of a wild card race. There is Oakland, who's a half game behind Tampa Bay in the wild card, so they're trying to chase to get that number two wild card spot. Boston, 6.5 games behind, the Rangers, 7, and the Angels are 10 games behind. But now when we switch to the NL, there's a very, very tight race trying to get those last few wild card spots. You have the Dodgers, the Braves, and the Cubs leading their divisions. Washington and the Phillies are currently holding the wild card spots, but you have the Cardinals a half game behind. The Mets and the Brewers are both 1 game behind. Arizona's 2.5 behind. The Giants, 3.5. Reds are 4.5. San Diego is 6.5. And the Colorado Rockies are only 7 games behind out of that wild card spot. So it's getting really tight in the NL. So we'll see how things shape up for the playoffs coming up in September, I believe. World Series is set for October. So we'll start seeing how things wrap up in the MLB when we get towards the end of the season. Switching focus to the NCAA football, the University of Navy has recently dropped their motto, which was "Load the Clip," because it has been found insensitive due to the recent shootings in the Maryland area, which is where the Navy is located. So that's one big thing coming out from them. Is, I mean, that's been their motto pretty much from. Since they were a school, I mean, it's been big.
And, you know, you saw it a few years ago with the Washington Redskins. You know, people were finding it insensitive, but they ended up not changing the name. But good job by Navy by taking the initiative and saying, hey, this isn't right.
Right.
And go ahead and changing it. But I think it's a good step for them.
Yeah, I do too. Because, you know, when they made it, it wasn't initially insensitive. But now, in today's society, it can be viewed as insensitive. So I think it's a good thing if they realize that and they're like, hey, let's just go ahead and take this down before it draws any more controversy.
So switching on to transfers, big news out of LSU, cornerback Kelvin Joseph going into the transfer portal. I haven't really seen too much of where he's going yet, but definitely some big news at LSU. Big time corner, I believe last year. He was a backup. You know, he had great defensive backs ahead of him, but you know, he had 12 tackles, a couple of pass deflections. So definitely a big losing some depth for the LSU secondary.
Yeah, no doubt. And we're known as DBU. One thing, we are losing a big DB that could have possibly stepped in, because we did have a lot of our defensive players get drafted in this draft class that recently passed. But that's transfer news at LSU. Moving on to transfer news out of Georgia, quarterback Justin Fields transferring to Ohio State. He is playing behind. He's playing behind Jake Fromm, who is looking to come back for one more year and lead the Bulldogs to the college football playoffs, hopefully. And then one more big transfer, DeAndre Francois, quarterback out of Florida State. Transfers to Hampton, which I believe is a D3 school. He was pretty much forced to transfer because of alleged domestic violence allegations against his girlfriend. He also had Florida Atlantic and Alabama State in his radar, but ended up deciding on Hampton.
Yeah, and you see that a lot, especially now and today. You know, they had the show Last Chance U on Netflix, and you saw guys with, you know, academic problems, just going down to lower levels and you know, playing and then looking to bounce back. So, you kind of see that nowadays between academics, behavior problems, and things like that. And hopefully he can get his stuff together and bounce back to his dream school. So, you know, we're talking about all these transfers and things like that. Talk about the recruiting class this year.
Yeah, no doubt. So we have here stats for the top five recruiting schools this year. Alabama, as per usual, is leading the pack. They had 3 5-star recruits commit this year, and a massive 23 4-star recruits are going to the Tide this year. University of Georgia had 5 5-star recruits and 15 4-stars. University of Texas ended up getting 2 5-stars and 15 4-star recruits. Texas A&M had 2 5-stars and 14 4-star recruits. And number 5 is LSU, who ended up getting 3 5-stars and 11 4-stars, along with a handful of 3-stars.
Yeah. And so with LSU, it's definitely, I know a little bit more about LSU since it's in our home state and things like that, but definitely some big-time playmakers that are being recruited now. Some guys, you know, may be underrated or overrated, but one thing I see from especially Derek Stingley Jr., one name that pops out for LSU or a recruiter for recruitment, definitely a good guy for the secondary. Probably, you know, some player people are saying he's probably going to be one of the best defensive backs that has ever suited up. You know, that's coming from Tyron Matthew, Patrick Peterson.
Both LSU great alumni.
Yeah, exactly. And that's great to see defensive-wise, but also offensive-wise, you see John Emery out of Destrehan. You know, I saw a thing on Twitter the other day where he broke a long run against the LSU defense, and that's a big, powerful defense that you got there. You know, you have Chesson, who's coming back, who actually got rewarded the 18 jersey.
Yeah.
And then also Cushenberry, I believe his name is, Lloyd Cushenberry, offensive lineman. And honestly, I put it out there for the big man, getting number 18, definitely well-respected along with LSU, his teammates. So going on to the recruitment, on to the power rankings for this year.
Leading off is number one, the reigning champions, Clemson Tigers. Following them is the Crimson Tide of Alabama. Coming in the three spot, Ohio State, following Urban Meyer's retirement. So let's see what the new skipper can do over there at Ohio State. Number four is Georgia, following that good recruiting class. Fifth is Oklahoma.
And big news from Oklahoma, Jalen Hurts.
Yeah, it's transferred to Oklahoma.
Oklahoma, so started for Alabama a few years, got, you know, wasn't performing too well. Tua Tagovailoa, I believe.
Tagovailoa, yeah.
Yeah, some, you know.
Yeah. I'll give you some leeway. Yeah, it's almost like Antetokounmpo.
Yeah, so, but Tua took him over. Not took him over, but basically replaced him. Jalen, you know, he was going to stick it out. He stuck it out for a year, got a few snaps and everything, and realized, you know, hey, I'm not getting enough playing time. I respect him for staying another year, though. He has all the love in the world for Tua. He's proud of him. But, you know, sometimes you got to do what's best for yourself and to further your football playing career. He's going to Oklahoma, and I think that's good for him especially, and good for Oklahoma because, you know, losing Kyler Murray. And so let's see what they can do over there in Oklahoma. Coming in number six is Michigan, and number seven, LSU, number eight, Florida, number nine, Texas.
That's a surprise.
Yeah, you know, week one matchup, LSU, Texas.
A little 7-9 matchup for the week one.
And coming in at number 10 is Notre Dame. So definitely a lot of news coming in from NCAA. And since we're just getting into training camp, fall camp, things like that, so looking to see what college football has in store for us this season. Now,
I guess that's all the time we got for this week. We'll be posting some videos around a weekly basis. You know, they probably won't be nearly as exact. Both Chandler and I will be starting our college classes within the next couple of weeks, so we'll try to stay as on target as possible with the time it takes us to make our videos. Chandler's going to be editing them because he's the technological wizard out of the two of us. So,
Kaden's a smart one. Just no common sense.
Yeah.
But basically, yeah. I hope you enjoyed Sports Rundown, first episode. Make sure to like and subscribe. Don't follow because I don't think that's a thing. But I said that in the first
video.
Yeah, so I'm not too sure if that's a thing on YouTube, but we're getting used to it, so make sure to like and subscribe. If you want to turn on the post notifications, you can. I really don't care. But make sure you watch our videos because you get all the sports news and things like that. But signing off, Chandler Cody, Kanan Bird, that's the Sports Rundown.